Hello and welcome to this snapcast in the series Atomic Theory. Here we look at all the short response questions that came up in 8 consecutive papers, and we'll begin with June 2007 and work our way backwards. Important that you try all these questions, and I'll try to build in some additional revision where I can. So, what's your answer to question 9? Did you get B? 9B is the answer. Let's look at its detailed configuration. Calcium's atomic number is 20. We put 2 in the 1s level, 2 in the 2s level. We put 6 into the 2p level, 2 into the 3s, 6 into the 3p, and that leaves 2 to go into the 4s level. For short, we could write the configuration as argon 4s2. Now, let me just revise or recap some jargon that's used. These numbers up the left hand side, 1 to 6, refer to the principal quantum number n. So that's n equals 1, or energy level 1. Principal quantum number n equals 2, or energy level 2, and so on. And they do go up as far as 7. What about all these little boxes? What are they? They represent orbitals. So orbitals. If we're talking about energy levels, we would be talking about orbits. But we were talking about these little boxes here, which can hold up to 2 electrons each. They are referred to as orbitals. And what about these little subsets? Like, for example, we have a subset here of 3 orbitals, and here a subset of 5 orbitals. What are they called? Well, the proper name for those is sublevels. For example, when it comes to principal quantum number n equals 3, you'll see that we have 3 sublevels. We've got a 3s, we've got a 3p, and we've also got 3d. Okay, let's move on. Pause the slide and have a go at both of these, please. Did you get this one? 1s2. 2s2, 2p4. Let's examine what that looks like, and to see that it does indeed have 2 unpaired electrons. This is it here. It is in fact oxygen, atomic number 8. And you'll see we have an unpaired electron here and here. These can be referred to as the 2px orbital, 2py orbital, and the 2pz orbital. In the 2px we have a pair of electrons, but the 2py and 2pz each have a single unpaired electron. Now question 6. What did you get for that? Did you get this one, 6a? Well, it has to have an electronic configuration 2-8. Now we know that neon has, with an atomic number 10, has indeed a configuration 2-8, but it has to be positively charged. So we're looking here for a metal that has lost electrons. We could rule that one out, and indeed that. I suppose these are possibilities, aluminium and potassium. Let's look at these in a little bit more detail. Well, the answer was aluminium, because if we lose these two and these, we form the Al3 plus ion. And you can see, in fact, it has the configuration 2 here, and then these two and these six give us 8, a configuration 2-8. Just to show the others were not possibilities. This would be gaining an electron, and yes, it would become 2-8. But it wouldn't have a positive charge, it would have a negative charge. That's why that was ruled out. With oxygen, it would have gained 2 electrons, one in here and one in here. Yes, it would have ended up 2-8, but it wouldn't have been positive, it would have had a 2 minus charge. Why did we rule out potassium? Well, simply far too many electrons. It had end up 2-8. Potassium ends up 2-8-8 with a positive charge. Pause this slide and have a go, please. So what did you get for your answer? This one. 1s2, 2s2, 2p3. Nitrogen has atomic number 7. 2 and 2 is 4 and 3 is 7. We can see it in a little bit more detail here. 2 in the 1s level, 2 in the 2s level, and then in the 2p level we have 1 in each orbital. Pause and have a go at this, please. Which is the smallest radius? All of these are isoelectronic. All four of these species have the same number of electrons. They all have a total of 18 electrons. Calcium as an atom has 20 electrons, but when it forms a 2 plus ion, it has lost 2 electrons and has 18. Potassium has atomic number 19. It normally has 19 electrons. It has 19 electrons when it's an atom. But when it loses one to form the K plus ion, it too has 18 electrons. Chlorine, atomic number 17, its atoms have 17 electrons, but when it forms a chloride ion, it has 18 electrons. Sulfur, atomic number 16, its atoms have 16 electrons, but when they gain 2 to form the S2 minus ion, sulfide ions have got again 18 electrons. They are all isoelectronic. Iso means the same as. However, which one has got the nucleus with the greatest charge, pulling these electrons in the best in order to create the smallest ion? Yes, the calcium ion has got 20 protons, therefore 20 positive charges in the nucleus, whereas the potassium has only got 19. Chlorine, we got that right. The chlorine has got 17 and the sulfur has got 16. Calcium has the largest number of protons in the nucleus, and when it comes to pulling those 18 electrons in, it will be able to pull them in tighter, and as a result the calcium 2 plus ion will be the smallest of these four. The answer is 1A. Let's have a look at that in a little bit more detail. I've circled in red here the elements involved. Sulfur forming S2 minus here, chlorine forming Cl minus, potassium forming K plus, and calcium forming Ca2 plus. These are all isoelectronic. They have the same number of electrons, in fact, as argon. They have the configuration 288. But the size of the charge in the nucleus is different. Calcium has got the largest number of protons in the nucleus. Let's have a look at the actual sizes. These are the four ions that we had to consider. And you'll see that the calcium ion in relative terms is 0.99 compared with potassium 1.33, sulfide 1.84, and chloride 1.81. In general, you see here that when it comes to metals that form cations, when they lose an electron, the nucleus with its will still have the same charge as the atom, and now having fewer electrons to attract, it'll be able to pull them in tighter. So when an atom loses an electron or two electrons, the resulting cation will be smaller than the atom. Same for calcium then as well. In fact, more so, the change in size between the atom of calcium and the cation of calcium is even greater than with potassium, because this time we're losing two electrons. So it shrinks even more, as you can see here. The reverse is true with anions. Sulfur is not losing, but gaining electrons. It still has the same charge in its nucleus, 16+. But that charge is now being shared out over two extra electrons, 18 electrons. And therefore, each electron is attracted more weakly. And as a result, the anion is bigger than the atom that made it. The same, but not quite as much, is observed when chlorine forms the chloride ion. In this case, it's only gaining one electron, so it does not increase in size by quite as much. But again, pause the slide and take this information in. To remove the first electron takes 578 kilojoules per mole. We have a jump here to 1817. It's obviously going to be more difficult to remove the second electron. The positive ion formed when this happens still has the same charge in its nucleus, but it has one less electron to attract, so the remaining electrons are held onto more tightly than before, and it takes more energy to remove the second electron. And the same is the case when we move to the next, the 2+ ion. Now has still the same charge in the nucleus, but again fewer electrons to attract, so it's going to be harder to remove the next electron, and so on. However, we see a huge big jump between this value and this value, and this tells us that for some reason it is much, much more difficult to remove the next electron. And this is an indication that we're moving from one energy level to another. So these three electrons here, they came out from one energy level, and this must be coming out now from a separate energy level. Because of the fact that we've got 1, 2, 3, this indicates that this must be a group 3 element. Could be something like aluminium. Once we've removed 3 electrons from an aluminium atom, we have the configuration 2-8. If we want to remove this 4th electron here, it means removing it from a full energy level. In this case, if it was aluminium, removing it from a full energy level 2. So the answer then is D, because we've established that it's going to be something like Al3+, or in general terms it's going to be M3+. Given that it's in group 3, it'll lose 3 electrons to form a 3+ ion. And with the 3+ ion combining with the oxide ion 2-, the simplest way to balance this is to take 3 of the 2- ions, 3 of the oxide ions, and 2 of the 3+ ions. Hence the formula is M2O3. Just pause this slide a moment and take in some of the general information regarding ionization energies. If you take a look here at a group 1 metal like lithium, for example, the big jump comes between the first and second ionization energies. It's relatively easy to remove the first electron from lithium, its configuration being 2-1. That electron is being removed from the second energy level. But if you go to try and remove another electron from a lithium ion, which has the configuration simply 2, you're now trying to remove an electron from a full energy level, energy level 1. And that takes an awful lot more energy, so you'll see a big jump there. If we go to beryllium, atomic number 2-2 for beryllium, removing the first takes, as you can see here, 899. Removing the second takes a lot more, but when it comes to removing the third, it takes an awful lot more. And that's because when it comes to the third electron, you're moving to another energy level that's full. We take a look here at boron. Boron is atomic number 5, configuration 2-3. Removing the first takes 800. Removing the second takes quite a bit more. Removing the third takes quite a bit more. But we try to remove, we've removed these three here. Once it comes to trying to remove one from the full first energy level, then you see a huge jump to 25,000. And again, if we looked at carbon in group 4, carbon is atomic number 6, configuration 2-4. Removing the first, removing the second, quite a bit more. Removing the third, quite a bit more. Removing the fourth, quite a bit more. But look at the jump when we try to remove another, the fifth electron. A jump from 6,000 up to 37 or 38,000. And that's because removing, once we've removed those four and we attempt to remove another one, again removing it from a full energy level 1. And the same pattern, if you take a moment, you'll see the same pattern there observed. We'll look at one last example, magnesium. Magnesium is atomic number 12, 282. Removing the first, 737. Removing the second, 1450. But look at the big jump we have here, right up to almost 8,000. Because once we've removed those two and we have to remove a third, it's coming from a full energy level 2. Okay, pause the slide and have a go at this, please. And did you get this? 1B, did you recognize that? Unfortunately, part of my slide hasn't come out, so we'll just have to do our best to pick this up. This represents the nucleus of the hydrogen atom, and this is the electron in the first shell. Now, what will happen, I'm going to show a scenario here where this electron here jumps up to the third energy level. So it's jumped from energy level 1, its ground state, up to a third energy level. That would happen if there is an input of energy, if the hydrogen atoms become excited by a supply of energy of some kind. It could also actually jump not from the first to the second, but maybe from the first to the third. And that's what I'm trying to show here. It could jump up to the fourth, so 1, 2, 3, could jump up to the fourth energy level, or indeed the fifth energy level, as a result of being excited by a supply of energy. The electron, however, will be unstable when it rises to a level above its ground state, and it will quickly jump back down again. But it'll have to jump down to one of the levels below, and as it does so, it will emit energy. I'd recommend that you write down this website address here and visit that web page, because it explains this extremely well. Now again, unfortunately, part of the diagram didn't come through in the snapcast here, so typical of what happens here, and it creates what's known as the Balmer series, is that these excited electrons jump down, strange as it may seem, to not back down to energy level 1, but back down to energy level 2. So if I can get this is the nucleus, this is the first shell, second shell, third and fourth and so on. Here we see an example of an electron that's been excited as a result of absorbing energy from some source, and then as that electron jumps back down, in this case to energy level n equals 2, quantum number n equals 2, energy is emitted. In another example, we might have one, for example, here coming back down to again n equals 2, second energy level, from 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 or whatever. This is the idea of how the Balmer series is produced. by electrons jumping from higher energy levels back down to energy level 2, quantum number, principal quantum number n equals 2. So what we see here is what has resulted. Is what this electron has jumped from here down to here, from energy level 3 down to energy level 2. This has jumped down from energy level 4 to energy level 2. This one has jumped down from energy level 6, I think, down to energy level 2. And this one has jumped from energy level 5 down to energy level 2. As that happens, the electron is moving from a higher energy level to a lower energy level. So as they jump down from a higher to a lower energy level, energy is released in the form of electromagnetic radiation in each case here. And as it happens, the radiation that is emitted happens to occur within the colour part of the spectrum. The colour part of the spectrum ranges from about 390 nanometers up to about 740 nanometers. You see here that as wavelength decreases, the energy increases. So this is increasing E, increasing energy level. And when we take a look at the spectrum produced from this, the so-called Balmer series, remember in this particular case the electrons are jumping from excited energy levels down to energy level 2, or N equals 2, not down to their ground state energy, which would be N equals 1. And these jumps emit electromagnetic radiation, which creates these bands in the spectrum. You can pause this slide for a moment if you want to refresh your memory about the Balmer series. There is another series that was discovered called the Lyman series, and in this particular case, instead of jumping back down to the second energy level, they jump back down to the ground state level, or principal quantum number n equals 1. And it says here, as a result, the atomic emission spectrum of an element is like a fingerprint, because importantly, no two elements have the same atomic emission spectrum. And if we can return to the original question, notice here that this and this look very similar. The difference is the labeling, the frequency versus the wavelength. What we observe is, with increasing frequency, we have increasing energy, so this could also be labeled energy. Whereas as wavelength increases, energy is decreasing, so in this particular case, energy is increasing from right to left. This is the correct one, because what we notice is, in terms of the energy levels, the difference between the first and the second energy level might, for example, be represented like that. This being n equals 1, and this being n equals 2. The next, the jump between n equals 2 and n equals 3 isn't as big a jump. And the next jump is even smaller, and so on. And that's what you should have observed here, that the bands in the spectrum are getting closer together, which is what we want. But we want them to get closer together as the energy levels increase. And that's what's being represented here. As energy increases from left to right, they're getting closer together, whereas it's the opposite here, and that's why this one is wrong. This is a colour version of the spectrum, but unfortunately it's the other way around to the one we looked at a moment ago. In other words, energy is increasing in this direction because the wavelength is shortening. Here's the hydrogen emission spectrum as opposed to absorption. This is what happens whenever hydrogen absorbs energy. This is what we're more familiar with, the emission spectrum. It's the same as we had before. And look at the way in which, as energy increases, albeit in this case from right to left, look what is happening to the bands on the spectrum. You'll agree that they're getting closer together. A relatively big gap here. Shorter. Shorter again, and so on. So this is what you expect. So look for the bands getting shorter. The gap between the bands getting shorter as energy increases. That's the important thing. Pause and give this one a go, please. Nitrogen is atomic number 7. Which one did you select? Yeah, this is the answer here. Pause again and have a go. What happens is you go down group 7. This is the correct answer, A. As we go down group 7, from fluorine to chlorine to bromine to iodine, they become less electronegative. What about the first ionization energy? Well, the atoms are getting bigger as we go down. So the electron in question that's being removed is further from the nucleus. There are more shells of electrons, which causes more shielding, so it gets easier and easier to remove the electron. In terms of reactivity, they become less reactive as you go down the group. So the answer is A. Let's have a look at that in a little bit more detail. Here we see group 7 and the atoms, so I want you to look at this particular column here. And you see the size of the atoms getting bigger. And the molecules equally would get bigger as you go down. F2 would be smaller than Cl2, etc. Again, it's worth revising the fact that when an atom gains an electron to form a negative ion, the negative ion, a so-called anion, will always be bigger than the atom from which it came. Same happens here. Oxide is bigger than the oxygen atom, and so on. With non-metals, the reverse is true. When they lose an electron, they form a cation that is smaller than the atom. Same with aluminium. Even more so, because aluminium is losing 3 electrons. And look at how much smaller the aluminium ion is. Moving on. Pause and have a go at this, please. So again, with ionization energy, we're looking for where the big jump comes. Is it between these two? Or these two? Or these two? Yeah, it's between these two. So we have 1, 2, 3 that are relatively easy to remove, but when it comes to the fourth, it's very difficult to remove. That's telling us that this must be in group 3. So it's a metal again, like in the previous question, in group 3, or certainly an element in group 3. It's got 3 electrons in its outer shell. Could be aluminium, could be boron. And so the answer then is C, something like AlCl3 or BCl3. Again, a short time ago I used this particular slide. You might like to pause and refresh your memory about it again. Like, for example, magnesium in group 2, relatively easy to remove the first two, but look at the big jump as we try to remove the third. Because it's relatively easy to remove the first two, that tells us it's in group 2. Look at nitrogen. Relatively easy to remove 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Then look at the jump from 9,500 up to 53,000. Tells us it's in group 5. Look at boron. Relatively easy to remove the first three. But look at the jump from 3,600 way up to 25,000 when we try to remove the fourth. Pause and have a go, please. oxygen has got in its atoms 8 electrons, fluorine has 9, sodium has 11, magnesium has 12, but these again are all isoelectronic. Iso means the same as, they have the same number of electrons, because when oxygen gains 2 electrons it's got 10. When a fluorine atom gains 1, it has 10. When a sodium atom loses an electron, it has 10. And when a magnesium atom loses 2 electrons, it has 10. They are all isoelectronic. Which one will have the smallest radius? It'll be one with the biggest charge to pull those 12 electron, those 10 electrons in. So that's why the answer is D. The Mg2 plus ion will have the smallest radius. Let me just prove that to you. These are the ions that we considered. Look at the red arrows. And we have the relative sizes here, 1.4, 1.36, 0.95, and the smallest 0.65. They all have the same number of electrons, these ions, but magnesium has got the largest number of protons in the nucleus pulling them in. Pause and have a go again, please. Relatively straightforward question. Did you get C? Gaseous chlorine atoms forming gaseous Cl plus ions and an electron. Pause and have a go, please. Well, P and S represent cases where it's most difficult to remove the first electron, so they certainly represent the group 8 or group 0 elements. They would have to be noble gases, and we see right away that's the answer. P is certainly a noble gas, because it represents a peak in ionization energy. Pause and have a go, please. Did you get D? Let's take a look at the reason why. So we're crossing here this period, the second long period or the third period, from sodium to magnesium to aluminium and so on. Sodium, magnesium and aluminium are metals. They have this metallic structure, cations, in a sea of electrons. These little dashes can represent the electrons. And metallic bonding is relatively strong bonding. In fact, most metals melt at a temperature above 1000, though sodium and aluminium have relatively low melting points for metals. But nevertheless, in relative terms, strong bonding. When we get to silicon, just like carbon, silicon has got a giant covalent structure, lots of covalent bonds, a giant structure requiring lots of energy to break it apart. So it's going to have a very high melting point. But as we move to the right of silicon, then we're going to be depending on van der Waals forces more, which are weaker bonds, and as a result the melting point will decline. Okay, pause again and have a go, please. So you've got bunsen flame and a lilac colour was seen. What does that tell us? Yeah, this is the flame test for potassium. And here we see what the flame looks like. Got this lilac colour. If you put potassium itself in a Bunsen flame, or a compound that has potassium in it, such as potassium chloride, potassium sulfate, potassium nitrate, then imparted to the flame will be this colour, which is a fingerprint for potassium. And this is what the emission spectrum for potassium looks like. And you'll see here a very strong lilac band in the emission spectrum. Pause and have a go, please. Fairly straightforward. That would be A. Let's look at this in a little bit more detail. The position of the element in the periodic table matches where the last electron is being placed. So it's in the S block if the last electron is going in to an S orbital. If it's going into a P sublevel, into one of the three orbitals in a P sublevel, then it's going to be a P block element. If the last electron is going into one of the five orbitals in a D sublevel, then it's a so-called D block element. And should the last electron be going into one of the orbitals in the F sublevel, the last electron going in there, then it would be a lanthanide or an actinide, one of the so-called F-block elements. Pause and have a go. So these are the hydrogen halides. And as we go down the group from fluorine to chlorine to bromine to iodine, the atoms are getting bigger. As a result, the HI bond is the biggest. The answer was D. Pause and give this a go. Atomic number of hydrogen is 1. Tritium is one of the three isotopes of hydrogen. This number here is the mass number. It's the sum of the protons and the neutrons. So if we subtract the atomic number from the mass number, we're left with 2, and that indicates that there are 2 neutrons. So there'll be 1 proton, 1 electron, and 2 neutrons. So the answer is C. Another one of these on successive energy levels. Pause and have a go. Where's the big jump coming this time? Is it between these two? Between these two? These two? Or these two? Yeah, this time the big jump is coming in here from 1,000 up to almost 5,000. So it's relatively easy to remove the first two. And that leads us to conclude that this is a group 2 element, and for that reason it would form the 2 plus ion. This would be something like, take magnesium as an example, relatively easy to remove the first two, then a huge jump to the next one. Or with beryllium, relatively easy to remove the first two, then a big jump to remove the third. Both of those are group 2 elements. Pause and have a go. The second ionization energy. So we're going to have gaseous X minus ions forming gaseous X 2 minus ions plus an electron. So C is the answer this time. Pause and have a go. Will not produce a red colour. What do you reckon? Yeah, I think it's pretty obvious. Sodium, of course, has the yellow flame colour. Let's take a brief look at these. Calcium, lithium, sodium and strontium. So it's telling us is that calcium, lithium and strontium all have a red colour imparted to the flame. Let's see evidence of that. First of all, here's the odd one out, sodium. This is what its flame looks like. And here's its emission spectrum. You can see the yellow band there in the emission spectrum responsible for the colour. Then the others are all red. Here's lithium, crimson red. You can see the band responsible. Here's calcium, described as a brick red colour. You can see the bands here responsible for that. And strontium has a beautiful colour. They're all different shades of red. Again, you can see the bands responsible for this. Okay, moving on. Pause and have a go. Now, W, X, Y, and Z all represent troughs. In other words, low points or points of minima. They represent elements where it's easiest to remove an electron, and that right away should signify group 1. So did you get A, alkali metals? And that concludes our look at all the short response questions that came up in this topic. Thank you for listening.